service here at Genesis Church in Huntington Pass, South Carolina. Of course, we got to get started with Children's Church from last week. These are cousins, Katie and Kenneth, and that's Katie with Y. I was told this morning to make sure how she spells it. And they play together. That's the reason why we have them so close together. Notice they've got these crafts. Miss Darlene and Miss Lisa always think of a craft to help reinforce the lesson that they're trying to teach. And we are just blessed with a lot of young people in the church this morning. That is just the heartbeat of the church and its future. And we're just so glad to have them here. Whether they're giggling, whether they're crying, it's okay. It just means that the church is growing and it's a future. And one day, hopefully, these young people that are sitting here will one day, maybe at our new location, have wedding showers and get married there and one day bring their own kids in. And that's what we're hoping. So let's see now. Last Sunday marked a special occasion. Rick, you know who that is? Andrew Roski, Andrew and John Roski's grandson, JT and Stacy Roski's son, Rhett, had his first Sunday at Genesis Church. And sometimes we forget to put that up, but we're going to start trying to do that when we have a little one. They make their first appearance here, but that's just cool. And it's a good occasion. Yeah. Y'all, Alan Harkey, a lot of you know Alan and Janet, they are a special part of the church. Alan was a former pastor here, and Alan has multiple health issues. He's going to have a heart catheterization this Wednesday, and I'm asking for special prayer for him and for Janet that his blood pressure will stay nice and normal during the procedure and after the procedure. Alan's blood pressure can fluctuate from 200 and something over 100 something to 70 over 30 in a matter of minutes. He's dealt with this condition for years. It's got a long name to it. There aren't many people in the country that have it. And when you do a heart catheterization, you have to go in through one of the arteries or veins, either in the wrist or in the leg. And in order for that to seal, you have to have pretty good normal blood pressure. Because think of it like for the plumbers in the crowd, if you have a weak pipe, that water pressure doubles. Or if it cuts in half, you're not getting the necessary pressure. So we want to lift him up. If y'all think about it Wednesday morning, please lift him and jam it up. And let's ask God to lead hands, hearts, words, and decisions that everyone's going to take care of. And y'all, we want to remember Mr. Swain Bowen. He lost his battle with cancer yesterday. Rich Bowen was really close to JT Roski, and been a good influence on him through the years. We want to really lift him and his family up. And that brings us to our prayer list. There are so many folks now that need it. Y'all, anyone that we can update on the prayer list, and y'all that are listening, please just put in the comments or message me if there's someone that we can add to the prayer list. Y'all, anyone that we can update? Is there anyone we can add to the prayer list? Okay, that gave you now get right.
A very good friend of the family, her son's in his mid-20s, and he's having heart issues. He's already got 3 stents, and his blood pressure is 200 over 100. And he's up at the hospital right now. And
what's his name?
His name is Dustin Leppard.
Yeah, how do you spell that last name?
L-E-O-P-A-R-D.
Oh, okay. Well, sir, we'll lift Dustin and his family up. Greg?
Yankee. Greg is bike this morning. Yankee.
Oh, Yankee?
Yeah.
Okay.
Greg is bike this morning.
Yeah. Yankee is a ministry name for a young man named Sean. And he is part of a motorcycle ministry that Brayden's involved with. And they came to, first time we got to meet all of them was actually at Pop Phillips' funeral. And they came in, and I'm gonna tell you what, Holy Spirit, just don't stay up here in the Sunday shirt. Those guys came in with the vest. Their leader, Jason Walton, who was was a longtime youth pastor at Chicola. He said a prayer that any pastor in America would be proud to have in their church. They do amazing work through that ministry. It is the Merge Ministries. And we'll definitely lift Sean up and pray now, send a prayer. If you have a number for him, I'll send a prayer to him after we get three. And let's see now. Y'all, anyone else that we can add to the prayer list?
Haley Corey messaged on here, school.
Okay. And we want to lift Haley up. Haley and her brother Logan and mother Jennifer came here a few times. Sweetie, I'll get to you in just a moment, I promise. And we'll, and Haley started school out in Ohio.
Mount
Vernon Nazarene University. Sorry, Pastor Barnes has been slow on the draw here lately. And from high school to college, that's a big old adjustment. That is a huge adjustment, and you go into a different place, and we definitely want to keep her lifted up. Okay, sweetheart. Okay, you're teasing? Okay, we'll lift Gigi up. Okay, Doug. We'll definitely lift Pat up. And, y'all, I just gotta say something. I think it's so cool that we have a little church where little ones aren't afraid to raise their hand and they're comfortable with asking for prayer. Because if we aren't ever known as anything else, if we're known as a house of prayer, that's a wonderful description. But we'll be praying for Gigi because falling is no fun. Pastor Mark found that he used to bounce a little bit. He don't bounce now. He just crashes really hard, and it is no fun whatsoever.
She's recovering from hip surgery.
It's thank you for reminding me, David. There's actually a couple more folks. I'd like to lift up my brother Robbie this morning. He's having some back trouble and wasn't able to attend this morning. And then also, Ms. Peggy Brock, she's here in the community. She's currently sick right now. We're going to lift her up. And then Ms. Judy Terry, she's a lady that Lisa and Jane and I have worked with through years at the hospital. Some of y'all may have seen her. She had dark-haired lady, nursing assistant, a smile like you wouldn't believe. Spent years in the emergency room. It's just a wonderful lady. She fell and has a hairline hip fracture. And we want to lift her up in prayer, too. Okay, then, well, y'all, I guess we're going to have a video, and then half the church is going to leave with Ms. Lisa, and they're going to hit the hand sanitizer on the way back, because you got to have clean hands before you have snacks and crafts. And the rest of y'all get bored with me for a little bit. Thank you for volunteering to go back here and help Ms. Lisa. That is just wonderful. When a church half empties out because you've got that many kids, that is just wonderful, and there's still a baby left in the audience. We're having a little hand sanitizer difficulty at the moment. Okay, we're all clear. Y'all, there's a couple ways I can tell if a message is going to be something someone needs to hear. Sometimes I'm just listening to it, and I can see a person's face when I'm putting it together. The The other time, it nearly is easy. I start having crazy dreams about a day or two beforehand. And it's usually the enemy trying to make me frazzled when I get up. And last night, I had the most, it was dreaming all night. And they were about these odd things, but they all end up pointing to failure or not able to make something happen. Has anyone ever gotten whacked out by their dreams? And I woke up this morning and I was just frazzled. I just did not know what was going on. And started praying about it. And I realized someone that needs to hear this. I don't know who it is. I don't know if it's someone that's listening right now, if it's someone that's going to listen. I don't know if we all need to listen to it. I don't know if it's something I need to listen to. But we had like scary rains and storms this week. And one thing I forgot to mention in prayer, we want to lift up those folks there in Louisiana right now. Storms, Laura and Marco are just aiming down for them right now, and they're predicting a double simultaneous impact. And it's going to be dead. It could be devastating. One on top of another. Turn for the weather, and we look at the rest of the news, and there's so many fights and battles, close to 100 days of demonstrations. People being put in the hospital, being killed. Businesses and lives being destroyed. I think we all have storms and battles in our lives. Have you never been that person that's standing right behind you in the grocery store, what they're going through? How many times have we been that person checking out a buyload or a people wiggler or whatever, and your life's falling apart and someone asks you how you're doing it? Oh, I'm doing fine. How many times have we been there? So many times we hide behind our mask, the smiling faces, to hide the true pain and battles we're facing. How many times have the happiest people on the outside been the saddest people on the inside? Many times we don't want to fight these battles. We try to avoid them. Might be enabling that person who's suffering with addiction. Be an addict who denies they have a problem, claiming they can control the habit when the habit is clearly controlling them. Could be trying to get someone else to fight your battle, even though that, you know, in your heart, it's only you and God. You are the only ones that can fix it. You believe it takes the responsibility from you, but it doesn't. Whatever it is, it doesn't. Does not take your responsibility away. There are millions of people in this country struggling with mental illness. That's a stigma to it. And it shouldn't. But it does. Insurance companies have been allowed to exclude a lot of mental health services. Across the board in every state, mental health department budgets are cut every year. Then we wonder why things are happening in this world. It's chemistry. It's not willpower. It is chemistry. Some part of it might be behavioral, but a lot of it is chemical. To make us have the moods we have, there are chemicals that are being released. There are chemicals that go back and forth to make us have our behaviors. Sometimes those chemical receptors, sometimes the parts of your brain that make those are all out of whack. People are struggling with this. Folks with bipolar disorder are struggling between basically being on a speed one moment and on downers the next. People with clinical depression, it's not. Got to have willpower, need a little sunlight. And don't get me wrong, sunlight and the will to change help, but you need help with doctors, counselors, therapists, sometimes the blessings that God provides is in the form of those hands and hearts and ears. The last few months have increased both addictions and mental illnesses. You think about all the people laid off. You think about all the people no longer have insurance, and this isn't a political thing. It's just the way it is. And you can't afford their medicine. Or they can't go to see their doctor or therapist in person. All these people are fighting with this now. This world can be a battlefield for all of us. Many of us have no idea what we need to do to survive the spiritual battles of our lives, let alone who's attacking us, who's defending us, and how we're supposed to fight this war. As Christians, we got opportunities for improvement. Research group conducted a survey of almost 1,900 Christians in the U.S. 78% said they believed in God. Doing the math, that's 1 out of 5 Christians don't believe that there is a God that created this world. Yeah. Less than half will think that Satan, about 47% think that Satan is merely a symbol of evil. I've heard people say this, I've heard pastors say this, there's not evil, there's just people that do evil things. No. Mm-hmm. 49% think that the Holy Spirit is a symbol. That the Bible is accurate, but the Holy Spirit is merely a symbol, an icon of God's power. So we got 1 in 5 don't believe there's God. We got about half that don't think there's a Father, a Son, and a Holy Ghost, but the Holy Ghost is actually just a symbol. We got 47 out of 100 that think that the devil ain't real. And only 55% think that the Bible is accurate in all the principles it teaches. That's not counting the history. They're not talking about history, but just what the Bible says is right or wrong. Satan's real. Satan's very real. People can say what they want to, and people may think I'm crazy. But I've felt real evil in this world. I've worked years in emergency rooms, and I've seen real evil. I have seen it. I have seen it come in many forms. Satan is waging a war on every single person in this world, Christian or non-Christian. And you look around, he hates us because every person born has this minute piece of God in him. Minute, small piece. That hatred intensifies if we let Jesus into our lives. We're in this fight whether we want to be or not, whether we believe in him. It's kind of like you don't have to believe in the bear, but the bear can still get you. You can say he ain't real, but he'll still get you. It's in a fight for our very souls. We're at a point in time where there are people that say doing unnatural things for children is a natural thing. That's wrong. You put me in Facebook jail, I don't care. That's wrong. There are people that believe that. Those people are welcome here. But this is the world we're in. This is being promoted as natural. Now, I don't care which way you vote. I don't care if you have a beer, or a cigarette, or whatever. Don't let it be the center of your life. But there are times, right, wrong, wrong. We're at a point now where we have crossed those lines, and they are tremendously blurred. Oh, he's fine. I think that is wonderful. Paul knew the importance of this spiritual battle. He knew what we would be facing if wrote about it in several of his books, Titus, Romans, and 1 Thessalonians. Most recognizable writing about the battle we're in and the weapons and strategies we need to use those found in Ephesians 6. Angela, he's fine. Verses 10 through 20. Verse 10, and Paul writes, finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. Paul uses really deliberate language here. He uses similar language throughout all his letters. Paul, in the way he wrote his letters, the way they were organized, was actually in the Bible by their length, not by chronology. Ephesians, Paul was getting going pretty, he was going pretty good, and he'd seen the good and the bad out there. He connects our strength with the strength of God. In 2 Corinthians 12:9, Paul wrote, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfected in weakness. There have been times in my life where I relied on just what I have and what I can do to make it through a tough situation. It didn't go well. It didn't go well at all. Pastor Billy Graham has this beautiful quote. When we come to the end of ourselves, we come to the beginning of God. I thought about that when I read verse 10 here. We're meant to be children of God and have Him involved in our toughest battles in our lives. One of Satan's favorite maneuvers is to make us feel we're alone, separated from God. But what's actually happened then? Did we leave Him? Did He leave us, or we left Him, or tried to leave Him? And we tried to leave Him. You may say, no, we haven't. But really, haven't we? You would pray to Him. It doesn't matter if you're in a pandemic or not. You can pray with a mask on or off. You can read this. Two factors that can strengthen your relationship with Jesus. This, and I don't mean cover to cover, but read a few verses. Just a few verses. Most Bibles have parts in the back. What to do when you're feeling down. What to do when you're feeling discouraged. What to do when you're feeling anxious. Verses about that you turn to. I have to. Those posts that I made on Facebook, I'm randomly pull the book, verses out. Many times I need them. I have to have them and pray. It don't have to be pretty. It don't have to be eloquent. It just has to be honest. Verse 11, Paul talks about putting on the full armor of God to stand against the schemes of the devil. What we need, the battle, the weapons we use, can only be furnished by God. It's the only thing that will stand up to the sin and the evil in this world. And in verse 12, Paul lays it out. Our struggle isn't against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the worldly forces, the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Flesh and blood flows, though. They're part of Satan's tools. Light, there's darkness. There's a Holy Spirit in angels. There is a demonic presence that counteracts. If you think about the world, everything's checked and balanced, things balanced out. If there's spiritual good in this world, there's spiritual evil. And it manifests itself physically. And that is what we're facing. But behind it, behind the good, there's the Holy Spirit. Behind the bad, there's the demonic forces of Satan. That's not popular. Some people associate this with closed mind, closed thinking. It's not. It's realistic. Satan is very real. And he has a wonderful public relations person. How many seasons was Lucifer on television? The TV show? How many times has Lucifer been portrayed? greatest feat, though, is to make people more anti-God. There's a Baptist church in Santa Clara, California right now, North Valley. And there was some stuff going on Facebook about them yesterday, and I always try to authenticate these things before I mention to them. They actually did have a cease and desist letter on the door of their church yesterday by the state of California, not to meet in person. They are faced with the decision this morning, I don't know what it's going to be, that came from the church, their Facebook page. Are they not going to open it? Or are they going to be a violation of the California state order? This is California. It could easily be South Carolina. It could easily be Illinois. It could easily be North Carolina. This is where we're faced at. This is what we're dealing with right now. The church did not say what they would do. We need to keep, churches need to pray for other churches. Christians need to pray for other Christians. Right now, 1 in 4 Americans don't believe in the existence of any God. Allah, our God, whoever, 1 in 4. Satan has been very successful at getting God out of our schools, our government, most of our health care. As a nurse in some states, if I tried to save a child that was born alive after an abortion, number one, I do not have the right in some states to refuse to participate in that procedure. Some states, I do not have the right to cut that child if they're born alive. I would lose my license. This is where we're coming to. There are bills that have passed through that do not include clauses to provide medical care for children that are born alive after these procedures. And I'm not in it to debate about the procedure itself. I don't believe in it. But no matter which way, if you have a child that needs your help, you help them. If you have a child that needs medical care, you're able to provide it, you provide it. But this is where we're at. Uses arrogance, pride, greed, and a thirst for power and control to manipulate people in doing this work from a local to an international level. We're having people, if you think about power and control right now, how much power and control is being placed on the average American right now? And this isn't a sermon about COVID. This is a sermon about, this is something that's been building up over 50 years. But there is definitely spiritual evil in this world. But it's okay, because we're not defenseless. Take up the full armor of God in verse 13, you'll be able to resist in the evil day. Our battles occur daily, within our own minds and outside. If we're honest, sometimes isn't it a struggle? When you're there and you see the opportunity to take a shortcut, or you see the opportunity to do something you want, but it's not necessarily the right thing. Isn't that little angel of the devil? Aren't they real? Yeah, they are. The battle starts within our own mind. Most people don't fall away from God in oneself. Nah. Most of them, we might learn by them in Sunday school, we might learn by them as an adult. Our hearts have good intentions, but like the disciples from last week, soul is willing, but the flesh is weak. And we start walking away one step at a time. Nobody starts off trying to wreck their lives. Very few people ever start off cheating on their spouses. I never heard a child in school say, I want to grow up to be an addict or have a mental illness. No one says that. One step leads to another and another, and before you know it, you've affected multiple families. Addiction, financial issues, excessive pride and anger. Sometimes people know they have a problem, but they're too proud to deal with it. And that pride just keeps right on going. carried him all the way down to construction. Armor of God is meant to be worn as a set, not a piece. Here or there, they're all connected with each other. In verse number 14, Paul talks about the belt or girdle of truth and the breastplate of righteousness. Using the belt of truth has two aspects. The first is we speak and practice truth. God made it real plain in Exodus 20, verse 16. Thou shalt not bear false witness against your neighbor. How many of us have been messed up with somebody lying on us? Whole fabricated lies, work, school, home, relationships, blistering damage. You know, the other end of that, don't we believe some good juicy gossip? Don't we? We all say, I try not to listen to that stuff. And then we're moving towards it. Most of us do. If we're honest about it, we're honest with ourselves. But the truth has another thing, though. Discernment. If you believe in truth, you believe in discernment. Discernment's something you need in this world. A couple took their daughter to the zoo. She got too close to the lion's cage. Fell in. This guy jumped off his bike, jumped in, popped one of them just as he was going to eat her, raised her back out, and panicked, said, oh my gosh, thank you so much. He said, my military training kicked in. To show their appreciation, they reported to the newspaper, headline the next day, U.S. military beats African refugee and steals his lunch. Discernment. We need it. Being a Christian doesn't mean you should be taken advantage of by someone or some organization that can lie to you for their own purposes. You can be a Christian and you can say no. Because what they're doing is a sin. It's wrong. If they're trying to get you to do something for them they can do for themselves, but they want to use you and manipulate you, that's wrong. If you watch five different news channels, you're going to get five different versions of the same story. We need truth and we need discernment to cut through the spiritual fog. When Paul writes about righteousness is one of those things that we think flowing roads and you don't say righteousness is just doing the right thing. Doing what you know is right. Debbie, it's alright. It's okay. Go back and check on me. It's all good. Yep, Ms. Lisa having a fun time. I don't know about you. I'm not seeing a lot of righteousness these days. I think about our presidential campaigns and some of the candidates, and one guy that sticks in my mind is Beto O'Rourke. And he ran for president earlier this year, and they asked him about the tax-exempt status for colleges, churches, and charities. Should they lose it if they oppose same-sex marriage? And he said yes, and I'm not saying one word or another on that, but the Bible says it very clearly how it is. I'll give him this. He had the nerve enough to say it. Basically what he's saying is, we're going to deny one group of people's rights for another group of people. And that's not right. If you have exemptions for Islamic law, and there are, if you have exemptions for other forms of worship, and there are laws on the books to have that, why is this any different? The presidential candidate got up and said he's going to deny Christians the right to have their own beliefs. He's not the only one. There are numerous candidates, local, state, and federal, well, they have made their opinions about the Christian church very, very clear. Whether or not you can vote for them. And that's one direction or another. Doesn't matter if it's Democrat, Republican, Libertarian, Independent. When you cast that vote, know who you're voting for. Because this battle is real. It ain't in Atlanta. It ain't in Greenville. It's Stevenson, Honeypath, Key West, Donalds, Rare Shoals. Know who you're voting for. School board, mayor, city council. Know what they believe. Take some time out. You're going to pick up your phone, you're going to research it. The person that's going to be deciding the taxes and what your kids are learning, research them too. It's not a Republican, Democrat thing. It's a right and wrong issue for the very soul of the church in America. You can't claim to be with God if you're hanging out with Satan and getting devil horn tattooed. By the way, I ain't got nothing wrong with tattoos. I don't have any issue with tattoos at all. But think about where righteousness comes from. It's from Jesus. Verse 15, Paul talks about shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And what he's talking about is preparedness to do and suffer what God wills, readiness to march as a Christian soldier. Being ready to roll when God has planned us to roll. Peaceful soul is one of the most rarest things in the world. They don't claim that their soul is at peace, born is not. I struggle with it. I struggle with tons of things I can't fix. I struggle with past failures coming into my life, coming into my mind. And it's hard to listen to the Holy Spirit. It's hard to hear when you have all that other stuff in your head. But why is peace so important for battle? Peace in our hearts can lead to more focused thinking and renewed strength. No one wants to fight a fighter that's feeling up to the challenge. Satan wants to stress, tired, and worried. Most Americans, he's doing a pretty good job. How many of us right now would consider ourselves sleep deprived on a regular basis? Most of us. How many times do we go on to Facebook or we go on the news and we can't get off of there before we are stressed, worried, tired, ticked off? And it's not just Facebook. It is other social media. It's the news. It's all there. Jesus shows his way to a soul filled with peace. In John 14:27, my peace I give you, not as the world does. I give you, let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. That's just peaceful. True peace. Verse 16, Paul writes about the shield of faith. What does it protect us from? Faith in God, His plan, Jesus and the Holy Spirit are a vital part of our defense against evil. I work with a fellow, he's an atheist, and he's a smart fellow. He's from New York City, and he tried to test me once. He poked and poked and poked, and then I brought up an example of faith. Asked him, do you think that we're just spinning around on this rock in the universe by coincidence? No, we just happen to have just the right atmosphere, just the right ingredients to have life. I know God's there, and I know that nothing you're going to say is going to change that. I've seen Him in my life. I've felt Him in my life. He found something else to do. He got tired of our religious discussions. But nice guy, but you're going to have people that are going to challenge you. You're going to have people that are going to say this ain't real, why you acting like this. Then you're going to have people that are going to distort it. Well, if you're a Christian, you ought to let me borrow your car. No. Because you tore it up. You tore it up. Why am I going to let you use mine? It's okay to say no. When someone's responsible enough to handle what they're handling, maybe. But if they're not, it's okay to tell them that. It's never right to be used by someone. Verse 16, when Paul wrote about Satan's darts, he was talking about the little attacks that can come in, flying in from any direction. Satan's darts are temptation, wrath, lust, revenge, and despair. Like an arrow, it may not kill you. That wound can get infected, and infection can spread. Get mad over something. Whether it's road rage, whether somebody says something about you on Facebook, whether somebody gave a nasty text or something. And before you know it, you've got more trouble than you ever asked for. Shield of faith can help with that. When we have faith in God and Jesus as our Savior, faith can be a great defense against those fiery darts that come out of nowhere and distract us. Having true faith also can help direct us. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 5:7, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." In verse 17, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Head is one of the most important parts of the body in any kind of battle. Paul's time of the day. I think the importance of salvation is expressed in the part of the body that protects the head, the mind. Salvation is defined as redemption of people by God, involving the forgiveness of sin and reconciliation to God through Jesus and the work of the Holy Spirit. Without a good helmet, you can have a great belt, breastplate, shield, sword, whole nine yards, and wouldn't be protected. When we're saved, when we're redeemed by Jesus, our salvation is started. Without salvation, none of that stuff works. Even demons have faith that Jesus is the Son of God. Satan knows it. But without salvation, none of the other pieces of the armor work. Paul uses the image of a sword to represent the Word of God, and it's not by accident. Think about when Jesus was tempted by Satan in the wilderness. Jesus was weakened after 40 days of fasting. Satan knew it. Tempted three times. How did he respond all three times? Scripture. When Satan tried to distort Scripture, Psalm, I think it was 122 or 119, Jesus kept answering. I think from the same chapter. It was like a sword blocking the strike. Satan seeks to blur our understanding of God's Word, using people to twist it, or trying to destroy it or distort it. There's no armor specified for the back in this, only for the front. I think that's purposeful. Paul was very deliberate when he wrote that. Don't ever turn your back on your enemy. Verse 18, Paul talks about praying and petition. Pray at all times in the Spirit. You need to talk to someone in order to maintain a relationship. And we pull God and Jesus out of our trunks like a spare tire when things are going bad. Is that a relationship? God has a ton of patience. But how would you feel? There's probably people in our lives. All the time we hear from them, you know, when you see that number, first thing pops in your mind is what they want. Is that a real relationship? Pray for the tools to fight this battle. And for God to be our general. We never know when we may need to do the Holy Spirit's work. We never know when we may be attacked. Our trials and struggles don't usually start on a schedule. They can happen at the worst time, they usually do. Verses 19 and 20. When Paul talks about being in chains, he's talking about being a servant. Paul gives glory to God and the Holy Spirit for his words and his actions. God's an active participant in this battle. It will let it be. As I read these last two verses, it occurred to me. I ask for this one, pray every day. I ask for the Holy Spirit to give me the words to say and the courage to say them. And when God's word is used, the faith and salvation, truth, peace, and righteousness, and our God is with us, we can face any foe in this world. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. Father, there is a spiritual battle fighting out in this world. It is just blazing. It's in our homes. It's in our schools. It's in our churches, Father. It's in every restaurant, every store, every piece and part of this country knows. It's in our own minds, Father. Give us the tools to fight this battle. Help us to be soldiers that are pleasing to do right in your eyes, Father. Help us to pick up our fallen comrades and help them, Father, find their wounds and help them heal. Because, Father, our churches should be hospitals for the spiritually sick. Never ever museums where masterpieces are put on display for others to look at. Father, each person that's listening to this, equip them with your full armor. Carry them out into this world, Father. Proclaim the gospel in their own way, Father, whether it is a kind word, whether it's a card, whether it is a phone call, whatever it is, Father. Each of us have our different talents. Use us, work through us. In Jesus' name, we pray all these things.